Our next presenter is going to discuss reading Revelation in the 21st century. Dr. David DeSilva is Trustees Distinguished Professor of New Testament and Greek at Ashland Theological Seminary in Ashland, Ohio. Dr. DeSilva completed a doctorate in New Testament studies at Emory University, a Master of Divinity degree from Princeton Theological Seminary, and a Bachelor of Arts degree from Princeton University. He is a prolific author and has published 24 New Testament books. He is ordained in the Florida Conference of the United Methodist Church. Dr. DeSilva has a wonderful gift for music, as we have been blessed to learn today. He is an accomplished church organist and choir director and has published numerous anthems and organ arrangements. In addition to his musical interests, Dr. DeSilva enjoys, and I took this right out of one of the websites, so I hope it's right, pulse-pounding movies, Indian food, and traveling to other cultures. So that's all good stuff. Above all, his chief love is spending time with his wife, Donna Jean DeSilva, and playing with his three sons. Let us give a very warm welcome to Dr. David DeSilva.
Although that website blurb was written before my three sons became teenagers, so don't get to do that quite as much anymore, since zombie apocalypse video games aren't quite my thing. I'd like to join the chorus of thanks to Pastor Jester and Second Prez for hosting this event and allowing us to be a part of it, and to Mr. Steve Schmidt for his diligence in organizing it and making sure we all got here, and is just his servant's heart and gift for hospitality. And I'd also like to thank the organist, Paula Roberts, for what I did to her registrations, and I have no idea what they ought to be, but, you know, you'll make that good, I'm sure, for me. Thank you. So I'd like to begin with perhaps one of the best read theologians of the 20th century, Charles Schultz, who gives us this cartoon, which reminds us of a basic, important point, which our previous presenters have already emphasized quite well. Linus coming back. Where have you been, Linus? Church school, Charlie Brown. We've been studying the letters of the Apostle Paul. That should be interesting. It is. Although I must admit, it makes me feel a little guilty. I always feel like I'm reading someone else's mail. And one of the most important things that perhaps we should take with us today, if we didn't walk in with it this morning, is that our scripture is, for the most part, somebody else's mail. The writings of the New Testament, at least, you know, the half that I play with, and by the way, I've decided after today I'm going to become a gospel scholar, so I can go earlier in the day, because this is ridiculous. I'm tired. Many of the writings in the New Testament came about because of the pastoral needs of Christians living in the first century AD. They are scripture, but they are not therefore timeless and without context, unlike the way, for example, the Tao Te Ching or the Dhammapada present themselves to their readers. And this was intentional. The early church could have collected all the useful theological and ethical wisdom from these texts, eliminated any references to their original setting, and made them timeless collections of inspired wisdom. Instead, the early church decided to retain and treasure the situational, almost incarnational, nature of these texts as scripture. We would not have Galatians if Paul had not sought to intervene personally in a situation that his converts in Galatia were confronting. 1st and 2nd Corinthians exist as a result of Paul's confronting a wide variety of issues and challenges facing that breaking bad church of Christians in Corinth. 1st Peter represents an early pastor's concern for Christians suffering harassment throughout five Roman provinces in what is now Western Turkey. Even Luke and Acts, we are reminded by the very first verses of each book, are not written for me. They're written for Theophilus, first and foremost, who is probably not friend of God and therefore, you know, kind of an anagram for me, but the guy paying for Luke's, you know, study leave, in effect, to have the opportunity to put this together. I mean, you can go to Corinth and find the name Theophilus, not the same guy, a military officer, in inscriptions. It's a real name. It was written for him first. And it's always salutary, I think, for us to remember that this is the nature of most of our New Testament texts, and so, as we will explore in just a moment, with Revelation, which leads me to what I regard as a critical rule for interpreting the Bible, which you've really already heard today. That's another bummer about going last, right? So much good stuff has already been put out there by my three predecessors. But try to understand what the text meant for and what the text was trying to bring about in the lives of its original intended audience or audiences, those Christians that were on the hearts of the writers. This is not just an academic exercise. It's not an attempt to keep scripture at arm's length. On the contrary, it's an attempt to really listen to the text and hear its words beyond the agendas and interests and limitations on listening that I would naturally impose on it by just reading it as if it were for me. It's an attempt to get beyond a passive hearing of those parts of Scripture that might fit into our context, to hearing how Scripture, if it's really allowed to have its full impact on us, can draw us out of our own context to look more critically at our accommodations to the world around us, to what that world has tried to make of us, with a view to letting God remake us, both individually and collectively, in those areas as well. And of course, it's also a great safeguard against harnessing the power of the Scriptures to give authority to bad, misleading, uninspired, and often outright damaging applications. Now on to Revelation. The first reader response commentary I read on Revelation was Hal Lindsey's There's a New World Coming. I say this playfully, but Hal Lindsey basically said, poor John was just trying to do the best he could, keeping up with the images coming his way, and he wrote them down as faithfully as he could, but he didn't know what he was seeing, but I can tell you what he was seeing. They're realities that we can resonate with now. But I would suggest that the first myth we discard in regard to reading Revelation is this myth: Revelation is about us. The letter formula with which the fourth verse of the first chapter begins, like the same formula in Galatians, 2 Corinthians, Philippians, whatever ends you want to turn to, reminds us of this. John to the seven churches which are in Asia, grace to you and peace. And again, when Jesus commissions John, he says, write down what you see into a book and send it to the seven churches, to Ephesus and Smyrna and Pergamum and the rest. Revelation is framed as a genuine letter to seven congregations in the Roman province of Asia. Revelation is, as Jonathan put it earlier, like Paul's letters, occasional in nature. It was written to help these Christians on the road to faithfulness. As a pastoral letter, then, Revelation addresses what is of concern to seven specific congregations that have grown up within this Roman province in the second half of the first century. John intended his letter to be understood by them, to shape their perceptions of their everyday realities, and to motivate a particular response to their circumstances. We would do well, therefore, to approach Revelation, at least in the first instance, as we do Galatians, just a really weird Galatians by comparison, as a message that was written with first century Christian concerns and challenges in mind. This, in turn, as we immerse ourselves in that context of listening, will help us as we return to our context of living to really hear what this text might shake us up about. And it probably won't be the endless games of pinning the tail on the Antichrist and what have you. The second myth I would suggest that we discard is that Revelation is about our future. Okay, granted, right up front, some things in Revelation obviously haven't happened. Jesus has not come back. The kingdoms of this world still go on their merry way, their fallen way, warping the inhabitants of this world and what have you. But by and large, Revelation does not even present itself as this futuristic forecast of what's coming down the road for the next 2100 years, or whatever, from the time it was written. Now, another reading cue that John gives us is one verse earlier than our last one, in 1:3. Blessed or privileged is the one who is reading out loud and those who are listening to the words of this prophecy and who are keeping the things written in it. And of course, that word prophecy appears as a label for this text throughout then chapter 22 as well. These contents being presented as the words of this prophecy tend naturally to set off false signals amongst 20th and now 21st century hearers, because when I hear prophecy, I think of Edgar Cayce or Nostradamus or those things you find in the Barnes & Noble, you know, bargain stack, you know, these endless forecasts or the Bible code more recently and things like that. But this presupposition about what prophecy really is what gets us most into trouble with Revelation. Is prophecy essentially prediction? To answer this, I would turn first to the prophetic utterances of the Hebrew Bible, such as the books of Isaiah, Jeremiah, and Hosea. While such prophecy could include a predictive element, it was also, and perhaps primarily, a declaration of God's action in the present, or even more frequently, an announcement of God's evaluation of the present actions of God's people, diagnosing problems and calling for a realignment with God's values. Prophecy is essentially a word from the Lord breaking into the situation of the Lord's people, when they need guidance or encouragement or a call to repentance and recommitment. Prophecy was also a regular experience in early Christian churches, especially Pauline Christianity. We find him trying to regulate how prophecy happens, and how Paul thinks of prophecy as basically words of education. Boah, Freudian slip. Words of edification spoken under the inspiration of the Spirit. Even in John's situation, the prophetess Jezebel, surely not her name, her activity as a prophet chiefly involves teaching, not predicting. And of course, think about, you know, Jonah. Yet 40 days and Nineveh will be destroyed. But even with that kind of short-range prediction, God's purpose was not to give a forecast. At least I presume that that was God's purpose because of God's response. Because the Ninevites repented and left off doing those things that God hated, God says, that was great. And Jonah's like, you're making me look bad here, Almighty. I gave a prophecy and now it's not coming true. And God's like, but what did you expect? Think about the people in Nineveh. What was really my purpose for this? It wasn't to tell them in 40 days I'm going to zap them. It was to get them to realign themselves with my values. I would suggest that we approach Revelation and its prophecy in much the same way, as that which God has spoken to inject a word from the Lord into the lives of these congregations to realign them with what was central to God's values for human society, human community, and witness. The third myth I would suggest that we discard is that Revelation is written in a mysterious code. We get, of course, Revelation from the first word of the book, an apocalypsis, a revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants what must soon take place. But one of the most basic assertions about Revelation is that it's written in a coded language, a language, moreover, that modern prophecy experts are better able to decode than any previous generation. See Myths 1 and 2. On the contrary, we are in a far less privileged position when it comes to reading Revelation than generations far prior to our own. Revelation interacts with a landscape that was very familiar to its first audience, but this landscape is for us a very distant and foreign landscape. If we lived in first century Ephesus or Pergamum, we would not have to wonder what John could be referring to by the cult of a beast or a prostitute riding astride a seven-headed monster. Not to say that that happened in Pergamum, but they would have gotten it, is my point. And if a copy of Revelation fell into the hands of a Roman official of even modest intelligence, the subversive intent of its imagery would not have been lost upon him. Apocalypse, the Greek word apocalypsis, means unveiling, not cryptic encoding. Revelation was not sent to those churches to be interpreted by them. It was sent to those churches to interpret the world of those readers. To put this another way, Revelation, the readers rather, did not need a special key to unlock Revelation. Revelation was the key by means of which they were to unlock the significance of their situation and the challenges that they were facing. Revelation lifted the veil from prominent features and persons and realities in the audience's landscape so that those Christians could see their world, the way things really are in light of God's scriptural revelation, in light of the bigger picture of God's purposes for the world and the conflict between the forces contrary to God and God's own forces, a battle that God would ultimately win. John thus sought to help his churches identify the real challenges facing them and to discern a faithful response. To sum up then, as a pastoral letter, Revelation addresses that which is of concern to seven specific congregations that have grown up within the Roman province of Asia Minor in the second half of the first century. As a prophetic word, as prophecy, Revelation announces God's perspective on the character and the challenges of those congregations, confirming loyalty to Christ and his covenant where such loyalty appears, rebuking unfaithfulness to the covenant where it appears, and calling for repentance. And as an apocalypse, Revelation sets before the audience the bigger picture, both in terms of time and space, that illumines and interprets what the Christians see happening all around them, helping them identify the real challenges facing them in their situation, orienting them to respond to those challenges in a manner consonant with this bigger picture. The starting point for reading Revelation in the 21st century, therefore, is to understand its import and impact in the first century, and thus to approach it first with questions like these. What would Christians living in the seven cities of Asia in the second half of the first century have made of this text? What realities would they understand John to be interpreting, preeminently in light of the Jewish scriptures and Jesus traditions that pervade Revelation? Just a little side note, for the most creative book in the New Testament, Revelation is also the most derivative book in the New Testament. There's far more per verse, that's the per verse, use of the Old Testament in Revelation than any other book of the New Testament. Oy. And then, how is John challenging them to respond in light of this God's eye view of their realities? I really hated preparing a 50 to 60 minute presentation on Revelation. It's terrible to do this. 4-hour presentation, no problem. Revelation is just, anyway. We can only think today about Revelation 17 and 18. This vision of the infamous courtesan Babylon and her fate. In the way that I'm suggesting. So from Revelation 17, I saw a woman seated on a scarlet beast that was covered with blasphemous names. It had 7 heads and 10 horns. The woman wore purple and scarlet clothing, and she glittered with gold and jewels and pearls. In her hand, she held a gold cup full of the vile and impure things that came from her activity as a prostitute. A name, a mystery, was written on her forehead: Babylon the Great, the mother of prostitutes and the vile things of the earth. I saw that the woman was drunk on the blood of the saints and the blood of Jesus' witnesses. I was completely stunned when I saw her. And other verses there from 17. The waters that you saw, the angel interpreting the vision, the waters that you saw where the prostitute is seated are peoples, crowds, nations, and languages. The woman whom you saw is the great city that rules over the kings of the earth, etc. What would Christians in Ephesus, Pergamum, or Laodicea have understood John to be talking about? And what would be the impact on them of this revisioning of those realities? So we look a little bit about the public discourse in Asia Minor and beyond Asia Minor about the divine emperor and eternal Rome. A story in praise of Roman domination. The members of the churches that John addressed were exposed daily to a well-defined story about their world and how it got the way it was. Inscriptions throughout their cities, the coins with which all business was transacted, statues, temples, civic processions, public announcements, all the available media of the first century tell parts of this story and keep its picture of the way things are visible. The public story of Rome begins with the fall of Troy, from whose ashes emerges a hero, Aeneas, who would plant the seeds of a world empire. If you didn't read the Aeneid, you may remember he was the guy that Orlando Bloom gave the sword to at the end of the movie Troy, as he left. Okay. So in the Aeneid, written by Virgil, a poet in Augustus's court, producing this court epic of the Augustan age, Virgil celebrates the promise of Zeus, the king of the gods, that the Romans would, quote, rule the sea and all the lands about it. The poet refers here to the Orbis Terrarum, the circle of the lands around the Mediterranean that was considered the civilized world. The map developed under the direction of Marcus Agrippa, Augustus's right-hand man and general, during his war against Antony and consolidation of power, illustrates this concept. A very, very small version of this is in your handout. The Mediterranean Sea stands at the center of the map, with all the known territories of Europe, Africa, and Asia, as far as India and Sri Lanka, arranged around the Mediterranean in a great circle, with a small opening between Spain and North Africa, the Strait of Gibraltar. This was the world that counted. Zeus proclaims in the Aeneid that Rome's destiny is to bring the whole world under law's dominion. The gifts and graces of the Romans were to pacify, to impose the rule of law, to spare the conquered and battle down the proud. Indeed, as the wings of the Roman eagle overshadowed more and more of the Mediterranean basin, it exercised, as John puts it, authority over every tribe and people and language and nation. Now, prophecy experts will say, ah, but there were the Goths, there were the Parthians. Clearly, John can't be talking about Rome as his one world empire, since Rome didn't, you know, beat down the entire world. But even people in the first and second century knew that, and they still use this universalizing language to talk about Rome's power. In the same document, they can talk about the Parthians to the east, but also Rome's control over all the lands. Minucius Felix, a second century Christian, who should have known better then, would write of the Romans that, quote, their power and authority has occupied the circuit of the whole world, referring once again to this concept of the Orbis Terrarum, the lands around the Mediterranean. Thus, it has propagated its empire beyond the paths of the sun and the bounds of the ocean itself. Plutarch, a Greco-Roman author, a near contemporary of John, celebrated the rise of Rome as it unified the Mediterranean region. He writes in On the Destiny of the Romans, Rome developed and grew strong and attached to herself not only nations and peoples, but foreign kingdoms beyond the sea. And then at last, the world found stability and security, when the controlling power entered into a single unwavering cycle and world order of peace. Rome was thus indeed seen as the great city that rules over the kings of the earth. These writers were aware that other nations existed and were not yet, at least, under Rome's domination. Nevertheless, authority over the kings of the earth and over the whole world was regularly attributed to Rome during this period. Now, I've given you some illustrations of coins from the first century, giving us some visual representations of Rome in this time. She's most often portrayed in the image of a goddess, the goddess Roma, the visible representation and embodiment, personification of the order, the rule of law, the peace, the stability that Rome's imperial rule brought. On some of these coins, for example, the first one, a denarius minted under Claudius, we see the face of a temple with, in Latin, Rom et Aug. These are small coins, so that's all they could fit in. That's Roma et Augusti, a temple dedicated to Rome and to Augustus, and the cult statues of the Emperor Augustus, and behind him, the goddess Roma, holding a symbol of plenty in one hand and placing a wreath of victory over the emperor's head with the other hand. Or on the Cistercius minted under Nero, Rome in her military garb, fully in armor with her helmet on, sitting on a pile of armor and shields and what have you, holding victory in the palm of her hand. I mean, the Roman propaganda was not subtle in its visual imagery like this. And then from another Cistercius by Vespasian, I keep hoping my wife will buy me one of these for Christmas, but it hasn't happened yet. We have the goddess dressed in a toga, reclining on the seven hills of Rome, with the river god Tiber at her feet over there. Rome is even more prominently visible for our audience in the cult statues that inhabit the temples erected in many of their cities. All seven of the cities addressed by John had either temples or shrines or at least altars dedicated to the imperial cult. And Pergamum was the seat of imperial cult through the first century. Roma was given the epithet Aeterna, an epithet that persists to this day when we hear Rome called the Eternal City. Tourist guilds still use that, unaware of the irony. Thus, Rome's supporters and propagandists advanced the bold claim that Rome's destiny was unchanging and everlasting. Plutarch reflects this when he talks about Rome providing a secure mooring cable for a period that would be unwavering, a rule that would last forever, thus forgetting all the lessons of world history. The prophecy expert that insists on looking to the future for a beast in his one-world empire needs to look more closely at the images projected of Rome in the first century and the perception of the Roman Empire held by most of its inhabitants, including John and his audience. Rome was also celebrated as the source of prosperity for the whole world. The luxury of Rome was promoted, was used as a sign that a golden age of prosperity had returned to the entire Mediterranean world. In a speech praising Rome, Aelius Aristides, another near contemporary of John slightly later, describes the scene in Rome thus. Around lie the continents far and wide, pouring an endless flow of goods to Rome. There is brought from every land and sea whatever is brought forth from the seasons and is produced by all countries, rivers, lakes, and the skills of Greeks and foreigners. Anyone who wants to behold all these products must either journey through the whole world to see them or else come to this city. One can see so many cargoes from India or, if you wish, from Arabia that one may surmise that the trees there have been left permanently bare and that those people must come here whenever they need anything. A wonderful text that bears witness in a kind of, I'm a clueless rich Roman sort of way, to the connection between consumerism and ecology that Dr. Garrett was pointing to earlier this afternoon. Aristides is oblivious to the downside of this Roman economy, because of course he's a very rich senator, and a strange hypochondriac, but that's a whole other story. But he's a member of the elite. He's a voice for the public official story of Rome. Such elite sources paint a picture of a world power that has brought tremendous benefits to humankind. An end to civil strife, protection from invasion, improvement of means of travel by land through expert road constructions. The roads there are still in better shape than most highways in Ohio. And travel by sea through the expansion of ports and harbors, as well as the dramatic reduction of brigandage and piracy. Trade is facilitated, steady distribution of grain and relief in times of shortfall improved, and the rule of law maintained. Thanks be to the gods indeed for Rome. Now, why would John not want his churches to look at Rome this way? Why would he be so intent on redressing Rome, showing us the goddess, as it were, in her evening wear? And some images are there just to help you. Imagine that. Thank you, William Blake. And a really fine young artist from Brazil, Fernando Real, for these images. When John speaks of a great city sitting upon seven hills and having authority over the kings of the earth, he speaks of a reality that resonates immediately with the hearer's experience. The seven hills of Rome were celebrated in ancient coinage, as we saw, but also in an annual festival in Rome that celebrated the enclosure of that seventh hill, and of course in literature. On this basis, both Christian hearers and outsiders, that kind of half-wit Roman official I named earlier, would immediately be able to connect Babylon with Rome. When John speaks of a city into which the wealth of the world flowed, one would not even have to be a Christian to make the obvious connection. And what an extreme makeover Roma Aeterna receives at John's hands. Why? Why should Christians not see Rome as the society would have them? Why is it so important to John that they not be amazed, stunned, awestruck, impressed by Rome, its power, its opulence, its trappings. Why will Rome's story not turn out the way Rome's spokespersons say it will? John has examined Rome's practices of domination, political, economic, and ideological, thoroughly in the light of God's prior revelations in Scripture, especially the Hebrew prophets who had long ago spoken against the self-serving practices of empire as contrary to God's good will for human beings in every nation and in the Jesus traditions. Revelation 18, as a whole, is a result of John's meditating upon texts from the Old Testament prophets indicting and pronouncing judgment on earlier self-serving, elite-serving empires. Ezekiel 27-28 against Tyre, Jeremiah 51 and Isaiah 47 against historic Babylon. What did Rome and its practices, global and local, look like from the point of view of God's standards and the kingdom Jesus announced? John has weighed Rome's practices in this balance and found them wanting. Rome's practices align much more closely to the practices of the empires critiqued by the Hebrew prophets and in writings like Daniel than with the just practices for which God called in those same prophets and in the Torah itself. Seen in this light, Rome looked very different from the image promoted in public discourse. Rome is guilty of charge number one, violence as a standard means of foreign policy, and violence against dissenters, especially against Jews and Christians. Second, Rome is guilty of economic exploitation, nurturing a system that caters to the luxury of the powerful at the expense of the many. And third, Rome is guilty of idolatrous presumption in its claims on its own behalf. John develops each of these charges in such a way as to arouse indignation against Roman imperialism, supporting his call to Christians to keep themselves free from supporting or participating in such an unjust system of domination. Now, because I can never write a presentation and really gauge how long it's going to take me, I'm going to fast forward a little bit. Thank heaven, said someone in row 17. So the first charge, maintaining empire through violence. We have a number of verses there where John just throws out and will not allow people to believe the propaganda about peace and security as the legacy of Rome, while forgetting its legacy of conquest and bloodshed. Empires forged out of conquest. A few territories came under Roman control peaceably, not maybe happily, but at least peaceably. It's like, there's no way we're winning this one. More, however, were taken by military force. Hence, all of these coins bearing witness to the taking of one province or another, or the retaking of a province, through military conquest. Egypt, Armenia, Germany, Parthia, and most famously for New Testament scholars, Judea, re capta, taken again. John's scenes of blood filling valleys and endless flocks of carrion birds gathering to feast upon the flesh of kings and soldiers are not merely products of apocalyptic imagination, but they were available to be seen, at some points at least, during John's lifetime. And even a man as highly placed in the empire as the Roman historian and senator Tacitus could see what Rome looked like from the outside. Imagining how a German chieftain would have commented on the advancing Roman army, he writes, "To violence, rapine, and plunder, they give the name government. They make a desert and call it peace." And also, John would not have his readers forget how Rome has silenced the witnesses to other systems of belief, other hopes, other allegiances to other kings and other gods, like the one God and Christ. Hence the vision of the martyrs under the altar in Revelation 6, 9 to 11. Rome is guilty of suppressing the truth violently, exchanging the truth of God for a lie, here the lie about Rome's rule, even to the point of executing God's witnesses through violence. That second charge, luxury and conspicuous consumption, secured by misery in a world of poverty. A number of places where John talks about the kings of the earth committing sexual immorality with this prostitute and becoming drunk with the wine of her whoring. John criticizes the Roman imperial economy as a system of self-interest structured chiefly to benefit Rome and those who got in bed with Rome. See, it's not just a modern idiom, getting in bed with. I mean, John used it. The elites and inhabitants of Rome consumed disproportionate wealth and goods in great measure to indulge excessive desires and cravings, what John calls luxury, while the poor in Rome's provinces were often short even on the necessities of life. The gaudiness of Roma Aeterna, dressed up now as a prostitute, draped in luxurious clothing, purple and scarlet, richly adorned, gold and precious stones and pearls, and sporting luxury goods, not just a cup, but a golden cup, highlights the visceral commitment to excess and self-indulgence that John saw in the Roman economy. He captures it again in his list, his focus on the extensive cargoes flowing from the ports all around the world, taking both staples like grain and oil and luxury items away from the provinces where they are produced to satiate a single city's cravings. We should remember that part of what Rome enjoyed came to her by way of trade, but another part came by way of tribute. That's trade without a price tag for the one who enjoys it. The enormous sums of money that each province collected and sent to Rome for the support of Rome's army, Rome's empire-wide building and military operations, and Rome's lifestyle. Being in bed with Rome was intoxicating, John says. There was a headiness about the propaganda about Rome's destiny, the prosperity enjoyed by her partners, the sheer magnificence of the capital and the power of her legions spread across the Mediterranean to ensure that the lusts of the few at the very top, in the very center, would be satisfied, along with the lusts of the few around the provinces that facilitated the satisfaction of those at the very top. The Roman economy, see if I can do this in 2 seconds, included supporting everyone in Rome with free bread. What that means, yes, 200,000 families, free bread. What that meant is all that bread, all that grain had to come from the provinces, and it had to come in fixed amounts at fixed prices. So if there was a little bit less one harvest in the province, Rome didn't feel it at all, but the provincials felt it. They either paid exorbitant sums for their wheat and barley, yes, a reference to the third horseman, or they went without entirely. John calls attention to this underside of the Roman economy, countering any feelings of gratitude toward Rome by drawing attention to the pervasive self-interest of so many aspects of this economy. An economy built, moreover, on the back of slaves. John may not be one of the great social prophets like Jeremiah or Hosea, but he's not ignorant of some of the social ills of his time also. And he highlights it, for example, by putting at the very tail end of his list of cargoes, bodies, even human souls, to highlight the trafficking in human lives, in slaves, that is at the very foundation of this entire system, without treating 1 in 4 people as a living tool, to use Aristotle's definition. You can't live the lifestyle and have the empire of Rome. This system's costs far outweigh its benefits, John wants to get across. And he wants to make sure that his hearers understand they cannot benefit from such an economy without also sharing in the guilt of such an economy. Arrogance and absence of accountability. In her heart, she says, I sit like a queen. I'm not a widow. I'll never see grief. That is why her plagues will come in a single day. Deadly disease, grief, and hunger. She will be consumed by fire because the Lord God who judges her is powerful. John looked out on an empire with no sense of accountability to the one God, his justice, or his vision for human society, with no humility in the face of the lessons of history that teach you no empire is going to last forever. But John knows a God who allots to all kingdoms their times and seasons. Rome's claims about its divinity and destiny are textbook examples of the arrogant presumption of imperialist thinking. And these presumptions will be exposed, John says, by God in God's time. The scene of the great prostitute stripped, naked, devoured by our allies, and burned up, which does have certain obvious problems with it as the portrayal of a female figure. But on the other hand, John is working with what he's been given, Roma as a goddess. So I'm going to show you what Roma looks like and where Rome's going, twisting the very material that I've been given. This vision of the great prostitute is John's final answer to the empire's projection of itself in the image of this divine goddess worshipped throughout subjugated provinces, thus leaving Roma Aeterna fully exposed in the light of Scripture and the light of the God, Scripture proclaims. John did all this to challenge his churches to live out witness more fully, more purely. The wealth to be enjoyed by participating in this larger global economy was, as far as John was concerned, a dangerous lure towards sharing in the violence and political injustice that undergirded such an economy, as well as sharing in the economic injustice that allowed the resources and produce of the provinces to be siphoned off to satisfy the immoderate cravings of Rome's elites and worldwide colluders. John understood long before the modern era that a person can't share in the profits of domination without also sharing in responsibility for its crimes. Come out of her, my people, so that you don't take part in her sins and don't receive any of her plagues. Many in John's audience didn't think a lot about Rome's political and economic practices, which also secured their own peace and prosperity as sins piling up in God's sight. We think, for example, of the Christians in Laodicea, who are like, I'm rich, I have prospered, I have need of nothing. That's a direct quote from Revelation 3. And don't realize the dangers of their self-centered mindset. As long as I'm happy and getting what I want, there's no problem with the way the world is. They didn't think much about the fact that benefiting from a system that renders some, or really many people, vulnerable to hardship means sharing in the guilt of the system that renders those people vulnerable to hardship. So John says you had better inquire closely of both the positive and the harmful effects of the systems in which you participate. And he calls them specifically to non-participation in a number of aspects of that system. First, non-participation in the imperial cult and the cult of Roma, the cult of the goddess, as a witness both against what Rome is doing and a witness to the very different way of living together as human society that God would bring to pass. This, of course, would come at great cost to the Christians in Asia Minor, where imperial cult was widely supported and popularly supported, really even at the heart of civic pride. I mean, you all talk about like sports happening today somewhere, but as much as you care about your sports team, so fanatic were the Ephesians and the Pergamenes about imperial cult and their temples, which gave them translocal prestige in this province. Right. John would not let the Christians he addressed, try to live out and benefit from God's story to some extent in some part of their lives, and to live out and benefit from Rome's story to some extent in some part of their lives. God's story had to be the only story, and Rome had to be understood and responded to as it appeared from God's story, which is quite different from the story Rome's supporters were spinning. This segment of Revelation, Revelation 17 and 18, especially was geared toward breaking the spell of Rome's propaganda, power, and opulence, so as to shake the Christians loose and set them free to pursue God's vision for them, rather than Rome's vision for them. So what? What is the challenge of Revelation 17 and 18 for us? It's obvious by now that I'm encouraging us to resist the approach to Revelation that seeks to use it to label some contemporary or soon-to-emerge person, country, or group, the beast, or the whore of Babylon. I'm not a preterist. I just don't want anyone to go out saying I'm a preterist either. Preterists who think John's prophecies refer to the past. Historicists, John's prophecy refers to the whole time of human history. Futurists, John's prophecies refer to yet the future for the most part. I wouldn't read Revelation as prophecy in any of those senses. So just don't go out saying, oh, DeSilva's a preterist. Actually, you'd probably go out, you know, you could say a lot worse than that, couldn't you? But rather, this is a pulling away of the veil that society has put over, the wool that society has pulled over the Christians' eyes, so they could see their world from John's perspective. John's precedent, then, in Revelation, summons us to do the same. How do our country's economic practices, political entanglements, and ideologies look when measured up against the proclamations of the Hebrew prophets, Jesus' teachings and example, and John's critique of his own imperial context? What systemic values have we as individual disciples and as collectives of disciples, churches, internalized? In what directions are we pulled that run counter to the call of God to holiness and justice, to allegiance to the global family of faith above all, to setting the kingdom of God first? This calls for careful study both of the scriptures, the frame of reference from which the examination takes place, and the real-life practices of our context and their effects on human beings within and outside our systems. So the first thing I would say is, John gives us a model of hermeneutics, a rather freakish one, but still a good one that we can learn from and imitate. He immersed himself in scripture. He knew it backwards and forwards, and therefore he knew what God liked in human communities and what God hated in human communities. What was in line with God's vision for how God's creatures should behave and what was out of line. He immersed himself in prayer and meditation, in that encounter with the Spirit of God that brought those insights to life and to bear in a convicting and life-giving way. And if I had more time, I'd have talked about Revelation 4 and 5 as a way into Revelation, which, by the way, when I first read Revelation as a teenager, I was 13, I was a really odd teenager too, by the way, I thought were really boring chapters. Oh, get to the good stuff. Get to the beast, man. Get to the beast. But chapters 4 and 5 really are the interpretive key for John, where you stand in front of God and the Lamb in the center of the cosmos. And everyone knows where the center of the cosmos is, and everyone knows their place around that center, giving worship where worship is due, except for these pockets of dissent here who think Rome is such a big deal and the emperor is such a big deal and the traditional Greco-Roman gods are such a big deal and what have you. So we look out at the world differently. And this is the essence of worship. When you come here tomorrow morning, it is to center yourself on God and on Christ in a fresh way so that everything else now is in a new place and has to find its place around this center, as opposed to claiming your allegiance as if it were the center. This is also dovetailing with those, really that prophetic thing we heard from Dr. Garrett about idolatry in our context. And then examining public discourse. What are people out there saying about what we're doing, about our lifestyle, about our values, about why we do what we do, in light of these first three experiences? And be watchful as Christians, because really John's concern is with the churches, not with the people outside the churches. I'm not saying we shouldn't be concerned about them. I'm just saying that diagnosis, evaluation, and recovery begins at home, in here. Where have we brought in the world into this church so that we are not living the witness to Christ? We are living the witness to Christ, world, God, mammon, God, mammon. And redraw the maps, you know, so that we think of God's kingdom as that body of people drawn out from every nation, language group, ethnic group, and I've forgotten exactly John's language at this point, as our primary nation, as the place where our primary allegiance is. And dare to see the world through God's eyes, through the lens of Scripture, which can be very scary, because it means, oh my gosh, suddenly the things that I have really enjoyed, like those poor Laodiceans, you know, if they really took John to heart, how different would their life have to be? I suspect a similar shakeup awaits many of us. And of course, finally, dare to set your hopes in God's future, as opposed to the future our world is having you craft and sets your own sights on. So that's kind of a model for hermeneutics that might come out of John. And the elephant in the room, talking about Revelation 17 and 18, is our economic practice here. So go to other countries and talk about Revelation and say, what country really resembles the Whore of Babylon? And like, well, yours, of course, you dummy. Oh, yes, well, you know, where does the wealth of the world flow? Whose desires and cravings are being most fed by the labors and materials and production and resources of others? Like every social system, our system fashions its members through education, through its media, through its everyday practices to want and to do what best serves that system. Our country tries to form us, first and foremost, not as people who are going to live subject to God and God's righteousness, but rather into good Americans. Most of us probably started school every day standing and saying the Pledge of Allegiance. And we are made ever since to think of our borders, our national security and well-being, our assurance of access to all the resources we need and then all the resources we want, and our way of life, which includes the unbridled amassing of capital for the purposes of self-gratification and preservation, as essential and inviolable, as goods to be secured without question. John challenges us first and foremost to live as part of that kingdom of God that God is drawing together from every tribe and language and people and nation. I remember it now, I wrote it down. That's why I don't come without a manuscript. There we go. He challenges us to give our primary allegiance to that kingdom. John believed that God wanted to make the redeemed something else, that God was trying to unmake much of what they had been made and to remake it after God's own image to serve God's ends for all humanity. Now, our economy, I'm no economist, but I have lived in it for 47 years, is organized around self-indulgence and consumerism. Our use of power and violence is often, not always, but often in service to this way of life. Pleasing ourselves, gratifying ourselves, consuming resources and experiences to fill ourselves are primary values and primary reference points. Our culture's mantras are, yourself is there to be gratified. Yourself is there to be filled. Yourself is there to be entertained. Yourself is there to be realized. This constant message makes us into people who will want and spend and live in the ways that keep a consumerist economy going. Our society makes us into the people it needs us to be to keep going as it's been going. A case in point is how this mentality is not limited to the mall, but invades our religious practice, how we shop for churches, how we evaluate worship experiences. I got a lot out of that worship experience today. I didn't enjoy the service today. I don't like the music of that church. Rarely, if ever, God was honored in that service today. God used me to bless my elders or my juniors in the faith with worship today. I gave myself wholly to what God wanted to work in me through the service this morning. Christ's call, following his own model of emptying himself and giving his life for the life of the world, is quite different from our culture's mantras. Yourself is there to die, and to die now before you die forever. Yourself is there to be lost for Jesus' sake and for the sake of the kingdom, if it is to be secure for eternity. Yourself is there to get out of the Spirit's way so that Christ can live your life, not you. John's challenge to his churches and to us is to decide, who will we be? Whose will we be? Into what kind of person will we allow ourselves to be made, and by whom? What is guiding our own spending? Is it self-gratification Or is it the command to love one's neighbor as oneself? What is guiding our ambitions for ourselves in regard to our employment, our vision for what our lives will look like in 5, 10, or 20 years? Is it the call of Christ, or the impulses of a consumerist economy and the conventional wisdom of personal finance? Ultimately, John is challenging us to really wrestle with the question, will you live here so as to be at home in this world, or so as to be welcome in the next? Will you invest what is in your hands to serve your own interests, wants, and yearning for security, or will you pour yourself out for God's interests and yearnings for this world and lay up your treasure accordingly? These are the kinds of questions John really seeks to force upon those who would keep the words of his prophecy, and not the idle questions about who and what and when. Too many people who are absorbed by the latter kinds of questions go on being and living just as Babylon has made them. And I'll end with a verse of a hymn, actually sung to the tune of the very last hymn that we sung, but it's a wonderful text from Peter Lombard. Now, in the meanwhile, with hearts raised on high, we for that country must yearn and must sigh, seeking Jerusalem, dear native land, through our long exile on Babylon's strand. Thank you for your kind attention. We have a few minutes for a question or two.
Now, okay, here we go.
I purposely kept the talk long so there wouldn't be time for questions. It's self-preservation at work.
So what do you do with 1,000 years in chapter 20?
Three minutes longer. And I could have made it out of here. All right, so the first thing I do with it is I think, what do the Christians in Ephesus do with 1,000 years? And I think it tells them at least, God is not unjust. You know, God is not going to forget those who have given their lives for God here. We might be the most despised, degraded, and trampled at this time. But at the same time, we are those who hold our heads up high, like those North Koreans about whom, was it Mike, informed us, who had to be able to hold their heads up high and say, yes, this is my Bible, and I'm not ashamed of what you're about to do to me. Because even in this moment, I know that while you reign in this world, I reign with Christ, and I share in his rule over you, in effect. Now, how that's going to play out, God knows. But the meaning of millennium for me is, you know, giving up a few years here to be faithful to God. You know, if martyrdom came today, giving up the 40 years I might have otherwise have left is really nothing. Because the momentary and light afflictions we now bear, and you can finish that verse. Actually, a better response would be, I don't know, what do you do with a millennium? Throw it right back at
anyone else? Okay. Thank you.